Morning, chat. Morning. Welcome to the emergency GameStop stream. Now, I decided to come on a little bit early today because there is some interesting market action going on. And you may not know this, chat, but 26969, the memes have it. The memes have it. You may not know this, but before I went into politics, while I was at law school, I did FINRA arbitration. Now, if you don't know what FINRA arbitration is, basically, when you get a licensed broker dealer, you can not sue them in court. They force you to sign an arbitration agreement. And we have this organization known as FINRA. And a FINRA arbitrator is someone who goes after basically brokers and financial advisors who defraud their clients through various means. Sometimes outright defraud. Sometimes they make investments that are what is known as unsuitable investments. Like if you have granny that's trying to make money from her savings, wants a fixed income, and then you go put her in, say, GameStop, and she loses all her money, you could be sued for making an unsuitable investment for your client, right? Every client needs to have risk tolerance, and they have every, and depending upon where, how old you are, you have a different suitable mix of investments, right? In order to achieve your goals, right? So FINRA arbitrator basically, they're on both sides of it. There's FINRA arbitrator that work to protect Wall Street banks and brokers and brokerage houses and investment advisors. And there are FINRA arbitrators who work on behalf of the plaintiffs, right? The people who got defrauded. So this gave me a lot of knowledge about how this shit all works. So I'm going to teach you all a little bit about what's going on. Now, right now, we are experiencing what is known in the biz as tulip mania. Now, this is a little cringe, but it's a good example, and it's bright and colorful in a cartoon, so maybe the Zoomers will be able to understand it. This is from Adam Ruins Everything, the origins of tulip mania.
Let's set the scene. The success of the Dutch economy meant that the middle class had cash to drop on luxury items, and tulips were one of their favorites. Well, tulips were new to the Netherlands and hard to get, which made them a status symbol. And rarer tulips with multicolored petals commanded the highest prices. In the 1630s, tulip prices began to rise. And then prices went from high to completely insane. Partly because of a unique feature of tulips. See, tulips only bloom in the spring. The rest of the year, the flowers turn back into bulbs and can be resold. But when they're flowering, they can't be moved. But that didn't stop people from wanting to buy them. So instead of buying the tulip itself, they'd buy a contract that meant they would get the tulip in the future. This is what's called a futures contract. And here's the important part. Once you had the contract, you could resell it to someone else, potentially for a lot more money. And that little feature brought out the financial speculators. In 1636 and 1637, the prices in this rickety market took the heck off. And the result was tulip mania!
So in other words, what's happening here in GameStop and AMC, it's not because people think GameStop is a good investment, okay? People are piling in to GameStop because they're seeing all the stories of their friends making some big money off of GameStop. I'm hearing stories in our very own Discord about people going, my friend just made $15,000. Did you see this guy on Reddit? He made $20 million. When I start seeing regular people talking about how great an investment it is in a stock, I know that they are what's known as the bag holders. Because eventually, the people with the extra money and the wherewithal to buy into the stock are going to run out. Also, the guy who bought GameStop when it was $100 or $5, he's looking at his gain right now, and he's going, I want that money. I want that $20 million to be stop being on paper and be real money in my bank account. And they're going to start to sell. And once they start to sell, then it's going to be a different story because new people are not going to pile into GameStop anymore. they're going to see that GameStop is not going up as fast as it was yesterday. I need to get out. And then there will be a rush to the exits. And that that kind of bubble here, this image has been around online for a long time. But this is what's happening. This is the bubble, right? So right now, back a couple weeks ago, some people started to get into GameStop. You know, they had a new CEO. They were restructuring the company. It had really been beaten down by a large percentage of short sellers, which we'll explain what those are in a moment. And all in all, it was probably a decent investment to get into GameStop. Then some more institutional investors got in. So in GameStop, we know there actually is an institutional investor in GameStop. Do you know who the institutional... Everyone is paying attention to this Melvin short seller, but there actually is an institutional investor who is in GameStop long. Do you know who that is? Do you know who that is, chat? Go ahead, guess. I want to see some guesses. BlackRock. That's right. You got it. BlackRock invested in GameStop. And it's even being reported. BlackRock has likely made $1.2 billion on GameStop as day traders buy the stock to stick it to Wall Street. Stick it to Wall Street. Yes, one part of Wall Street is getting owned. One part of Wall Street is getting owned. And that's funny. Melvin and a lot of these other short sellers are getting owned. But never doubt it. BlackRock was there first. BlackRock was there first. And if we look at this chart, I want to show you this chart. Let's do a month. You see that? Let's make it 5 days. See that back and forth? Yeah, look at that. There. Look at this chart, chat. Look at this chart. It's almost identical. It's comical how often this repeats. See that bear trap? There was that first spike where it went up to 100. That was 2 days ago. And then it went all the way back down to 69. Would you look at that? So we had our bear trap. Look at that. We have a bear trap just like this chart. Now, the chart is not identical, but you could see it, right? You could see it. Bear trap. And then the media attention, enthusiasm, public greed, delusion. Where are we at right now? We are in this stage right here. We are in this stage right in the here. We are in the greed, delusion, enthusiasm, media attention phase. This stuff happens so fucking often that this chart, which was made years and years and years ago, is going to be true. Do you think doing an aggro short on GMA would be a good plan for the... Are you fucking asking me for financial advice on a Twitch stream right now? Are you crazy? Are you fucking crazy? Give me $10,000 and then I'll start answering your financial fucking questions, okay? I am not doing this for free. I'm just showing you, this is what we're in right now. This is what we're in. So we had the delusional greed spike. Here we are. We are in the tulip mania shit. What is the real price? What's the real price? It's just to you today. What's the real price of GME? I don't know. $40. $25. If you really go by the fundamentals. What is it now? $300. Now, am I saying sell? No, I'm not saying shit. I'm not giving you any advice. I'm just pointing out that we are in this delusional part. And if you think that Wall Street didn't win, Wall Street wins. They own the casino. Okay? You're never going to beat Wall Street by trading stocks. We're not going to trade our stocks to a socialist utopia. They own the casino. It's a rigged game. And how does BlackRock win? Let me see. BlackRock buys to see Robinhood flow. Twitter freaked out over Robinhood selling its trade flow. Zero Hedge made a splashy return to Twitter over the weekend, months after being banned from the website. The financial news site's first order business attacking Robinhood, the popular retail investing platform. Tweeted on Saturday that retail investors are moving markets because Robinhood sells its order flow to high-frequency trading firms who front-run the trades and increase momentum. In other words, whenever you make a stock purchase on Robinhood, they send that information to BlackRock first so that BlackRock can buy the stock you wanted to buy, mark it up a couple of cents, and then sell it to you. And they also can see what all the users on Robinhood are doing so that they can go, whoa, there's a big movement among retail investors to buy GameStop. I'm going to buy GameStop too. They can see. That's what high-frequency trading is. Let me see if I could find a clip explaining high-frequency trading. Okay, let's see. Okay, this is short. Hopefully this is going. If when it's propagandistic, I will refute it for you, chat. It's not moving, chat.
High frequency trading
uses computer
algorithms to automate trading and replace the role that humans once had in the market. They earn a small profit from the spread on a trade. In most cases, that amounts to only a few cents at best. There are many exchanges and they compete on offering the best price. When one price updates, they all update. So those prices come and go very, very quickly. Modern trading can take place in barely comprehensible measurements of time. Banks and high-frequency traders often boast of executing orders on stocks and futures exchanges in milliseconds or thousandths of a second. To put this into perspective, the average time it takes a human finger to click a mouse is a leisurely 150,000 microseconds. To be the fastest, they must use super-fast computers and telecoms cables, and even put their IT servers in the same room in the data center as the exchange. For the exchange, this rent is a nice little sideline. Not all high-frequency trading companies are the same. Some act as market makers, buying and selling other people's trades. Others use their own capital to earn a higher profit. But in general, they tend to be small companies, and the big ones often have no more than a couple of hundred employees at most. Some depend purely on speed and look to iron out any possible inefficiency in getting a signal.
Okay, so the purpose of this, all this IT equipment and microwaves and fiber is so that they can front run the trades. They see you make a trade, you want to buy, you say, hey, I want to buy a share of GameStop. They go and see, oh, this guy's selling GameStop at $25.11. They buy that GameStop at $25.11. They turn around and they sell it to you for $25.13. And they do it in a millisecond. They made 2 cents on that share just because of their physical location. And they knew what you were ordering and they ran ahead and grabbed it and then turned around and flipped it to you for a couple more cents. And so they never make, they hold that share for a millisecond. And they make a little bit of money. Now, if you do that by billions of times, suddenly it adds up to real fucking money. So BlackRock can do that. So they could do it two ways. They can front run your Robinhood trade. So increase your cost, right? Increase the price that you pay while also skimming a rent off of it. And they could also go into a trade that you're already in and run along with the crowd. So BlackRock is the one that's owning. Now, if you're still confused, I'm assuming that a lot of you know what's going on. Maybe we should take a step back and explain what's happening. So what is happening right now? There are big hedge funds and small hedge funds who do what is known as short selling. Short selling is basically the belief that a stock is going to go down and to make money off of a stock going down. If you think a company is a shit company and you think its stock price is too high, you can make money by short selling that stock. So what is a short sell? There's a broker, and the broker keeps all the shares that its clients own. And what the clients can do is they can tell the broker, hey, my shares that I own, they're available to be lent. If somebody wants to borrow my shares, they can borrow my shares, but they have to pay interest on that. So when they borrow my shares, they have to pay interest while they're borrowing my shares. So what a short seller does is it goes to the broker and says, hey, I'd like to short sell some GameStop. And the broker says, all right, Mike owns 10 shares of GameStop. Here's his 10 shares. You're going to be paying 10% interest on the value of the shares when he lent them to you. You grab those shares that you borrowed, and then you sell them in the market, and then you get the money. So you basically get, so say the shares of GameStop, the 10 shares were trading at $10. You get $100 cash, and it goes into your brokerage account. It also has a note in your brokerage account, borrowed 10 shares of GameStop. All right? And if the stock goes down, say to $5, you can go to the market, buy 10 shares at $5, pay $50. You take the you have $50 profit. Then you come back to me and say, here you go, Mike. Here's your 10 shares back. And I get my 10 shares back. And you keep $50 profit. Does that make sense? That is short selling. So here, short seller borrows 10 shares of ABC stock. Short seller sells 10 shares of AB stock for $500. Stock loses value. Short seller buys 110 shares of ABC stock for $400. Short seller returns 10 shares of ABC stock and keeps $100. That is what a short sell is. So what happens if it goes the other way? What happens if, instead of the stock going down like you thought, the stock goes up? Uh-oh. That's what's known as a short squeeze. Because at some point, the broker is going to look at your account and say, hey, Mike, you have the $100 you had from selling the shares, but you also had the $100 that you had to deposit into your brokerage account in the first place. I can see that the stock has gone from $100, $15 from $10 a share to $20 a share. Mike, if it goes up to it's at $15 a share, excuse me. If it goes up to $20 a share, I'm going to take all your money and buy those stocks back because I don't know that you're actually good for any more money. If you want to stay in this trade, you got to deposit more money into your brokerage account, or I'm going to execute a trade on my behalf to protect the brokerage firm from losing money. That's what's known as a short squeeze. So, for example, so what happens if you borrow those stocks from me and they go from $10 to $20 and you just have $200 in your brokerage account, the broker will grab your money out of your account, buy those shares and give them back to me and say, sorry, that's a margin call. You just got squeezed. The stock went up too much and you didn't have enough in your account for us to cover the risk. I'm sorry, you have lost everything. So does that make sense? So if the stock goes up when you short sell, the broker will look at your account and sees how much money you have in it. And the moment that your money in your account goes to zero, they'll take all on paper, they'll take all that money and buy those stocks back to protect themselves from your dumbass trade. So now what's happening is all those Robinhood, all those little retail investors on Wall Street Bets, they're going and they're saying, what are the stocks that have high short interest? And they said, GameStop. GameStop has 142% of its float is shorted. Well, what does that mean? Float is the total number of shares available in the market. Greater than 100% means that people have borrowed more than 100% of the shares available to be traded and sold them short. The fact that it's at 140% means that the same share has been borrowed more than once to be sold short. Meaning there's a huge amount of people out there who have borrowed the GameStop stock and sold it, and they haven't bought it back yet. Well, that gives that opportunity. So what's happening is, according to Wall Street Bets, they're saying that the float actually hasn't done. Now, there is a story that's in GameStop about GameStop, about Melvin, which was the hedge fund. Now, why did this hedge fund want to short GameStop? Well, GameStop is a shit company. GameStop was the next Toys R Us. It's coronavirus, so no one's going to stores anymore. And GameStop's entire business model was based on the fact that you would take in your physical games and old consoles, trade them in for rock-bottom shit prices, and then you would use those to buy more physical games and consoles. Well, the market for physical games is massively down. So you have a retail store where nobody's going to it because of coronavirus, and you have the fact that it's based in the old form of buying and selling games, which is the physical discs. And you could say, this company is a dinosaur. It can't compete with the digital delivery of games, and it can't compete on physical prices with places like Amazon. By the way, Amazon also has its own buying back program. GameStop has all these retail locations that they have to pay rent on and pay employees for. This company is shit. This company can't compete. This company is a dinosaur. So a lot of these investors went to GameStop, saw it as a doomed company, or a company that maybe that there's a market for it, but it's much, much smaller than it was in the past. And when a company is shrinking, that's bad in our capitalism world where everything must grow, 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 bigger, bigger, bigger every year. You can't just be a stable business that makes money. You have to be a bigger business than you were last year. So they went in and shorted that. And SpaghettiO, the rest of the market is starting to crash. SpaghettiO. So what's going on with GameStop right now? GameStop was up as high as $300 and it's starting to tail off, chat. SpaghettiO. No, we're going to the moon. Well, the thing about going to the moon, chat, is that you don't just want to go to the moon. You want to go to the moon and you want to return safely to the earth. Hopefully with bags of cash, right? You don't want to go up to the moon and stay there because guess what? There's no oxygen up there. There's no food up there. It's negative 150 degrees in the shade. Not exactly the nicest place. You want to go to the moon and you want to return safely to the earth. How many of you are going to end up burning up on reentry? How many of you are going to end up with a bronze statue for dumbassery as opposed to walking around with your GameStop dollars? So what's happening? What's happening? Well, chat, there's now stories out that Melvin Capital, also like chat, this is like the perfect story. The hedge fund is called Melvin. Literally, the only better name for this stock would be Poindexter Capital. Poindexter Capital would be the only other fucking name that would be better than this. Anyway, so, all right, so we've talked about this. We talked about Robinhood. We talked about how BlackRock is the real company making all the money. And here's the thing. It's not just, SpaghettiO. It looks like Wall Street Bets may be running out of momentum, chat. It may be running out of momentum. AMC was closed at $5, opened at $20, and is now at $6, now at $15. What did I tell you, chat? What did I tell you? You are literally seeing this shit happen in real fucking time. You are seeing this happen in real fucking time. Don't you ever, ever, ever think that you're going to beat Wall Street at their own game. They rig that game. Truly, you owe me $3,000.
Now, on what has turned into the soap opera and saga of the markets right now, and that is the story of GameStop. The news to bring you right now is that Melvin Capital Management, this is the hedge fund that had shorted this company that had effectively been attacked by an army of investors trying to push up and press up the stop, the stock rather, of GameStop along the way. Melvin Capital is now out of the stock. They got out of the stock, from what I understand, yesterday afternoon. I just got off the telephone with Gabriel Plotkin, who runs that firm. They've taken a rather huge loss. I do not have the full number on what that loss looked like. As was reported yesterday, both Citadel and Point 72 have infused something on the order of close to $3 billion into Melvin Capital to try to shore up its finances. Gabe Plotkin telling me just moments ago that the speculation that the firm would file for bankruptcy is false. There's some reporting taking place on Reddit, where so much of this discussion began and really created the momentum for, as I said, an army of investors using options to try to press up that price. To some degree, they might be able to argue now that they succeeded. If this was really about vanquishing, if you will, Wall Street, or vanquishing a hedge fund manager. In this case, they did take a loss. They may have not put them out of business, but boy, did they come close. We've been following this story, which has been such a wild one. GameStop shares right now, I mean, I don't even know what to say. It's up 131%, $342 on any.
I mean, the stock. Okay, first of all, it's not that price anymore, chat. GameStop is now at $285. And so it's down off of its high of the day was on the open. The high of the day was basically on the open. And it is curling back. The broader market is down 1%. GameStop here is flowing against the market. This is 100%, and everybody knows this. I'm not explaining anything. Surprising here. I mean, like, look at this. Net income negative $464 million. 2020 sales growth negative 22%. I mean, the company is garbage. It's a shit company. The whole market is down largely because Boeing just ate shit. Boeing is one of the bigger stocks in the market, and Boeing had one of its worst years ever. And they're pushing back a lot of the deliveries. So it's just a diabolically bad company. Like, look at this. They've had sales. They're losing sales. Oh my God, why is this chart so shit? Holy fucking Christ, I hate this website. Like, they've been shrinking as a company for 5 straight years. Their revenue is down year over year over year over year. This company sucks. The company sucks. They're losing money. Their pre-tax income was negative $500 million. We like the stock, I heard. Oh my God. So the bubble, the tulip mania in GameStop. How's AMC doing? Actually, I want to look at GameStop on Google here. It doesn't have a PE ratio because it's a loss maker. It loses money. So you can't have a PE ratio with a negative number. Look at the 1 week chart. Uh-oh. We're already down $100. Uh-oh, chat. Uh-oh. Let me show you Tesla stock. So here's something I want to talk to you about. There's no problem. This same shit that we're seeing here in GameStop is happening in Tesla. There was a huge short interest in Tesla. But the people that did the short squeeze in Tesla They were institutional investors. They were the rich. There were some small retail investors. But the same shit you're seeing in GameStop, you're seeing in Tesla. Tesla's at a 1757 price to earnings multiple, an $840 billion market cap. They sell 500,000 cars a year. Total cars sold by Tesla. All time. I want to say all time. So, in May of 2020, they sold 999,000 cars. Let's just, for the sake of argument, say they sold another, they have sold 1.25 million cars in Tesla's history. All right? 1.25 million cars. Let's just get the calculator out here. So for each car, I didn't add the spaces. Google added the fucking spaces, but thank you for the correction. For each car that Tesla has sold, the company is now worth $672,000. Does that sound reasonable to you? Tesla isn't just about cars, though. It's about their battery and solar more than anything. Except that's all speculative and it's not bringing them any money in, Salvador. That's why they're priced. I mean, you're saying in the future, maybe. What is the global battery market size? The global battery market size is $108 billion. Tesla's worth $800 billion. If they sold every single battery in the world, it's still only $108 billion. Let's go solar market size. The global concentrated solar power market size was valued at $3 billion? That's it? Okay, hold on. The global solar energy market was a market at $52 billion. I need to actually find this actual... How big is the solar market? The global solar energy market was valued at 52.5 billion. That's for the power... Power generation. So all batteries and all solar panel generation is not even half. If you had 100% market share in all battery and 100% market share in solar power, it wouldn't even be $200 billion. The company's worth $800 billion. It's 100% an out-of-control speculative bubble. And you would have to be delusional not to see that. Is there some promise? Yes, but all that stuff about, you know, Tesla batteries and electric vehicles and all that, that's already baked in. We're now in full-on tulip mania mode. We're on full-on new paradigm, delusion, greed mode. What does new paradigm mean? At the top of a bubble, a lot of people will go, whoa, this company or this stock or this futures contract is massively overvalued. What's going on here? This doesn't make any sense if you actually look at the underlying company. Why is the price this high? And the response is, it's a new paradigm. This company is reinventing X thing. You know what? And just so you know that, and just so we have some good examples here, let's look at the Crocs bubble. At one point, Crocs were going to be the new thing. Now, look at this. We were back. I wonder if there's a bubble, chat. Anyway, back in 2008, when Crocs were invented, there was this big old, oh, they've reinvented shoes. They've reinvented shoes. Nobody's got to buy a regular shoe again. It's a new paradigm. And everybody went into delusional mode again. And then all of a sudden... Well, maybe Crocs aren't going to reinvent. Everyone's not going to be wearing Crocs. And then it went down again. So fast, and then the crash. Now, what's really interesting is the Crocs have exploded out of control in 2020. What the fuck? What's the story here? I need to look into this. I think we may have a bubble in the stock market, chat. I think we may have a bubble in the stock market because I'm not seeing Crocs. You want another one? How about this? Enron. Oh my god. Let's see if I can still even get this. Here we go. Enron stock chart. Same shit. Same shit. How about another one? Taser. Oh my god, this one is probably another one of them. Oh my god! You think we might have a bubble? I was gonna talk about this bubble. Holy shit. Crocs collaborations. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Tell me what's going on with Crocs. Post Malone Crocs are sold out. The Pizza Slime Crocs. The Crocs and Justin Bieber are not sold out. The thing about the GameStop bubble is it's 100% speculation. And everybody knows it. Oh, wait, wait, wait. They're fighting back. The retail investors are fighting back. It's back up to 300. But if you look at this, if you look at this, if you look at this chart, this is not how a real company... Even Bed Bath & Beyond. Oh, God. Bed Bath and... Oh, my God! We want to say it's Robin Hood, but I made a tweet. I made a tweet about this morning when I woke up. Funny thing about this Robin Hood and GM and GameStop situation is that the people who make decisions about the economy believe that markets are rational. It doesn't matter that every 6 to 8 years, the whole thing blows up and needs bailed out by the government. They'll send sheriffs after Robin Hood. And when I say that, you think the hedge funds are going to let you do shit like this to them? That they'll let you find where they have a bunch of short interest and a shit company with a small float and then all pile on them? Hell to the no. They will make Wall Street bets illegal. They will send the FEC after Wall Street bets. They'll arrest the mods of the fucking thing. They'll find out who the posters are. They'll shut down Robinhood itself before they let the hedge funds get fucked. Because the hedge funds have something you don't have. Lobbyists. Republicans in their pockets. Democrats in their pockets. They'll find some sad sack story about some grandma invested in a hedge fund for her fixed income retirement who's got glaucoma, wheel her out to a House hearing, and drop a nuke on your ass. Important advice, the rich will never let the poor win, even using their exact same methods. If the rich start losing the game, they'll just change the rules. That's exactly how it works. Which is why the neoliberal belief that we can win the capitalist game is never real. Free markets are not free. It's a rigged game. It's a big club, and you ain't in it. So if you are one of those people that made a lot of money in Robinhood, if you're one of the people that's involved in these trades, I would tell you, enjoy it while it lasts. And I don't begrudge anyone for trying to make a buck. But I can tell you right now, I'm telling you right now, that right now we are in this part. When you start seeing media attention, you start seeing greed and delusion, they're already in. BlackRock was already in this trade before it was on CNBC. Remember that. BlackRock was in this trade before CNBC was reporting about it. We didn't beat Wall Street. One part of Wall Street got devoured by another part of Wall Street. That's all in the game, yo. You didn't crack shit. Because if there's one thing that Wall Street Bets does not have an intimate relationship with, it's soap. It's soap and fragrance. Can you imagine what a Wall Street Bets convention would smell like? I can tell you, it doesn't have a lot of experience with Bed Bath & Beyond. So they certainly aren't buying this because they like the store. Because they've never been in one. Can you explain the BlackRock thing, please? Sure. BlackRock is a big institutional firm. And BlackRock is, it's just another big, BlackRock has lightly scored a big fund of investors. It's another big institutional events investor. BlackRock has likely scored a 700% gain on GameStop this month, thanks to day traders boosting the stock. The world's largest asset manager owned 9.2 million shares worth 174 million at the end of 2020. BlackRock's 13% stake has surged in value from 174 million to around 1.4 billion since then. The GameStop saga is being framed as the little guy sticking it to Wall Street. However, the world's biggest fund manager has probably made $1.2 billion this month thanks to those amateur investors pumping up the video game retailer stock. BlackRock disclosed in a regulatory filing on Tuesday that it owned 9.2 million shares in GameStop at the end of December. GameStop's stock price has skyrocketed from 19 to 448. So it's actually more. So they have, what's it at right now? What's GameStop at right now? GameStop is at 130. Okay, so we just need to do the old calculator. So 9.2 million times 312. They're now up to nearly 3 billion. Almost 3 billion. $2.9 billion if they're still holding. If they're smart, they're laddering out of this shit right now. So what does BlackRock do with that asset? Try to reboot GameStop or just liquidate and walk away? Liquidate and walk away. They're going to dump this shit on all the game. They're going to dump this shit on all you fools. On all the people. And I've seen a lot of people I like. Or I've seen relatives. I've seen friends. This is how I know something's a bubble about to burst. When regular people start jumping in, that's when you jump out. That's when you jump out. And this stuff, so what would I do? I mean, I am a gambler at heart, so I might gamble. But the thing is, I've got my stream, you know? I would never play with any money that I didn't have that was extra. That was laying around for a rainy day. I would not put my student loan money into this like other people are doing. That would be unwise. I'm not a financial advisor, and this isn't financial advice. I just have a knack for explaining things, and lots of people have asked about this topic, so I thought I'd share my own personal thought. Jesus Christ. To date, the GME play has been pretty simple. Buy and hold and wait for the squeeze. Whether that comes in hours, days, or weeks. Try not to have a heart attack during the intermittent gamma squeezes. Keep your hands diamond strong during the manipulated downward spikes. And buy, baby, buy. Holy shit. This is the dumbest thing. It's rapidly become apparent that we will soon enter the GME endgame. Before you can come up with an exit strategy, or if you're still on the fence, decide whether to jump in, you need to form an opinion on the GME bull thesis without considering the short squeeze. One brain-dead simple way to calculate a fair stock price is for a company to use a time revenue valuation. You take the company's revenue, $6.66 billion in 2020, and multiply it by some magic number, often 0.5 for low-growth companies and 2 for high-growth companies. Divide the float, number of shares available to trade. The times revenue multiplier of a 0.5 gives a GME's price of 64, while a multiplier of 2 gives it 255. Oh my god, if you fall for this, you are the dumbest idiot. You are the dumbest of the dumb. Yes, just take financial advice, important sounding financial numbers and multiply them by other whole numbers. And now you have a price for the stock. It's just that easy, folks. Oh, God. If Melvin Cavill thinks GME is overpriced at 20, then a Times revenue valuation would suggest a multiplier of 0.16. That's an extraordinary low for a retail business. You apply that multiplier to Best Buy, you get a stock price of 30. Best Buy currently tried, which works out to a much more reasonable multiplier. Did Best Buy lose a lot of money for the last 5 years? They have $550 million in debt and more than that in cash. Net cash positive. That's a good reason to think GameStop is not going bankrupt in the immediate short term. But that's not a growth multiplier of 2, my dude. Also, this is out of date because his top number was 255. It's already well beyond 255. So even his delusional high growth number, it's already well beyond that. Oh my God. Oh no, chat. GameStop is back up. Oh no. So where could it go? It was just a bear trap. Oh no, no, chat. Oh no, 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 no. Are we at? I'm not trying to call the top, by the way. I'm not trying to call the top. I don't know where we are. Are we still in the greed? Are we in? Did we get into the bull trap? Are we getting in the bull trap right now? Is this the bull trap? I don't know. 420.69. If those memers cannot get GameStop to 420.69, I swear to God, they're a fail. Oh! Is Melvin out or not? Well, there's a report that Melvin is out.
The kind of fundamental basis, if the stock were worth more than $20 or $30, I think it would be something to behold. Real questions, of course, about stock manipulation, about the power of what's taking place on places like Reddit. Really, what's motivating this type of trading behavior at all? It clearly has nothing to do with the fundamental.
It's the same thing that motivates all trading behavior. Greed. Unearned income. That's the only thing that motivates stock trading in the secondary market. Unearned income from owning capital. That's it. And it's just regular retail investors, of course, and BlackRock.
Fundamentals of GameStop itself anymore, and much more to do with pop psychology of who's gonna be left holding the bag. The thing that concerns me most at this point is whether some of these investors will actually start to get out today. They'll look at this and say, "We won the game." If that's winning, unclear. You know.
Wait! What is making money, winning the game on Wall Street? It's amazing how they suddenly get philosophical when it's... Honestly, I'm not trying to burst everyone's bubble here, but it is pretty funny how when a hedge fund shorting American retail workers gets slapped across the face with regular people's dicks, suddenly, is life really all about money? Is on CNBC.
Where the finish line is in that regard, but... as much pain as they may have created for Melvin Capital, for example, my great anxiety at this point is the number of retail investors that have been jumping into this in the last 24 hours who very well may get hurt.
A lot of people will get hurt. Let me just say this: GameStop is not a $330 stock. If you buy now, you're probably going to get hurt. Maybe it goes to 1,000. Maybe it goes to 500. Are you going to have the discipline to take profits? Because all this shit, it's on paper right now. If you have made a lot of money in GameStop, 5-10 times your initial investment, you need to... There's an old saying. I'm not telling you what to do. Let me just say, there's an old saying. Bulls make money, bears make money, pigs get slaughtered. You gotta realize that this is just a casino. This is like putting chips on the roulette wheel and hitting. If you keep spinning the roulette wheel, the game is rigged. You will go home with no money. You just hit double zero.
Far more and lose far more.
Buy low, buy high, never sell. GameStop will never again be this price per share.
Than some of the hedge funds that were involved in this. Let's just show you where we are right now. Joe mentioned at the top of the program, Elon Musk tweeting yesterday, which also...
Apparently there's a guy on Twitch called the Stock Guy. And right now we're in a record bull market. Okay? We're in a record bull market. Except for the coronavirus shit, we're in a record bull market. Literally any idiot who just buys stocks is gonna make money. The Federal Reserve has pumped infinite cash into Wall Street. That's the truth. So, what does that mean? It means if you're making money right now, you're probably not that smart. The government and the system is rigged in order for it to go up. But eventually, the disconnect between the actual economy and the stock market is gonna run into some problems here.
Powered the stock even higher. I mean, there's nothing normal about what you're seeing when it comes to this.
Jamie Dixon's private jet is en route to DC. Is that true?
Right now, stock up 51% on Friday, 18% on Monday, 92% yesterday. As I said, soaring in the pre-market. Let's just give you a little bit of a rundown to explain what's happened. Shares popping early in the session. This was yesterday when Chamath Palihapitiya, also somebody who's taken to Twitter and whatnot, really trying to push up this stock. And again, it really raises some important questions about what these people are doing, why they're doing it.
Greed?
I don't like to think of the market as a game, but that's really what this has become, this stock in particular, a game. He tweeted that he bought February $115 calls on GameStop. The night before, he tweeted, "Tell me what to buy tomorrow, and if you convince me, I'll throw a few hundred Ks at it to start." Shortly after noon, then you had Cameron Winklevoss tweeting, thinking about going long GameStop. And then after the close, Elon Musk jumping into the action, tweeting, "Game stonk," which is a reference to the popular meme and linking to the Wall Street Bets Reddit page that's been hyping all of this throughout, that Musk tweet helping drive this pre-market move right now. Later this hour, we're going to talk to Robert Frank, who's been reporting on the biggest winners, and really, frankly, we'll see the losers of this GameStop trade. But a lot to be concerned about when you think about what's happening here. Where are the regulators? And is this just the beginning?
Where were the regulators when Tesla is valued at $800,000 per car sold? It's not a problem when the rich get richer. Where are the regulators when Amazon does nothing but predatory anti-competitive practices and busts unions? No regulators there. Everything's A-okay. But regular people fuck over one hedge fund with the cooperation of another hedge fund, and it's a problem. What is the GME option chain looking like? GME option chain. Holy shit. They only have $200 puts. There's not even any puts up here. There's no puts even written. It's almost at $400 and nobody's written a put over 200. Oh my God. Implied volatility 1000%. incredible! You can't even buy these things! Oh, okay, sorry. Sorry, let me explain these things. All right. So, there's something known as derivatives. Have you ever heard the phrase derivative, chat? Have you ever heard the phrase derivative? I'm gonna try to explain this stuff. So, basically, you can buy and you can sell stocks. All right? We talked about short selling earlier, if you remember when we brought up this, the chart. Where the hell is it? Here we go. We talked about short selling. Well, there's another thing you can do. It's called option trading. What is an option? An option is the right to buy or sell something at an agreed upon price until some date in the future. So, for example, I could buy an option to buy Apple stock at $100 a share until November 2022. So from now, if I have an option to buy it, that's called a call. If I have an option to sell it to you, that's called a put. All right? So, for example, imagine ABC stock. I have a price to sell it to you or buy it from you for $100 by January of 2022, right? If ABC stock is trading at $95, then I'm not going to exercise that option because I could just go to the market and buy ABC stock at $95. However, if ABC stock goes to $105, I could go to you and say, I would like to exercise my option to buy ABC stock from you for $100. Then you sell me your stock at $100, then I could turn around and I could sell that stock on the market for $105. So that would be an in-the-money call, right? So for each option, you have somebody who writes the option and you have a buyer of the option. What's the right an option writer? Well, an option writer is somebody who says, I own ABC stock, for example, in a call, but I don't think it's going to go over $100 next year. So I can make a little bit of money if I let Mike have the right to buy the ABC stock from me at, if it goes above $100. So I'm going to write a call. That's what's known as a covered call. And calls in America and puts, the standard contract that the CBOE, the Chicago Board of Options Exchange, they write standard options contracts, and they're for 100 shares. So if you own 100 shares of ABC, you can write one covered call. Similarly, a put is the opposite. The put is the right to sell to you a stock at a certain price. Say the stock is at $200 and So call is I buy it from you, put is I sell it to you. So say I own shares in ABC and I think it's gonna go up, right? I could sell puts, I could write a put to you in order for me to make extra money on the stock not going down. So I can actually own the underlying stock and I can write puts. You could also do the same thing and you could write them what are called naked puts and naked calls. I could just write a contract saying, yeah, I'll buy that stock or I'll sell that stock to you at that price, even though I don't own the underlying security. And if something bad happens, I have to go to the market and buy the stock in order to deliver it to you. Does that all make sense? Is this making sense? No? Oh, fuck. All right, let's look at the chart. So this is what's known as a long call. So we have the strike price. Strike price is 100. So when I buy a call, derivatives are so hard to explain to people. Okay, let's look at an example. GME. All right. This is a call to buy GME, which is GameStop, at $10. Right? You have an option. So there's no open interest. Okay, so these have all been executed. Okay. Oh my God. People are now making money on the meme. This is the worst merch I've ever seen. This merch sucks! where did I learn this without being econ? I did securities arbitration in law school. Doesn't even have a transparent background. Omega law, exactly. Two shades of black on the shirt. Trickle down grifting. So people are getting $300 stocks for $1, basically? Yes. That's it. So if the call option strike price is at $1 and you own the call, you have the right to buy the stock at $1. Then you could turn around and sell it to the market for $300. And the opposite is true. If a $300 put, if the stock is at $1 and you have a $300 put, you can buy the dollar stock from the market and sell it to the person that you have a put with for $300. They have to buy it from you for $300. Does that make sense? Okay. If that doesn't make sense, nothing will. So, but what the derivatives do is they allow you to get leverage. And there's actually more complicated derivative strategies. We could talk about strangles and straddles. And you can buy a call and sell a call as well on the same security for a certain, because you could do like a certain range. There's all sorts of things you can do with derivatives. And so you can make money on a stock if the stock goes up, if it goes down, if it goes sideways, if it's volatile. You can make a shit ton of money if you can, if you correctly predict the moves that the stock is going to make. I think there's a lot of underlying concepts here that have the vast majority of people just would have no reason to have seen before. Yes, absolutely. Even better, the people who are being forced to buy the stock at 300 are the funds to cover their own short, out of the money short position. That's correct. So here you go. So the strike price. So the advantage to buying and selling a call is that, the advantage of buying a call or put is that you have a maximum loss that you can take. You can only lose as much as you invested into the call or the put. Now, if you short a stock, you have an unlimited loss if you short a stock. If you buy a put, you have a limited loss. So you can make money if the stock goes down with a put without risking unlimited loss. Whereas if you short a stock, then you risk unlimited loss. Now, you don't have unlimited profit in a put because the stock could only go to zero. So there's a maximum theoretical profit. On a call, there's unlimited profit because technically the stock could go to infinite. But there's not, it's not really unlimited profit. There's a theoretical range, right? But if you write calls and puts, then you have risk of unlimited losses. AMC has almost 700 million volume today, and it's only 8 a.m. Oh, my God. Burn it down. Play options. Use the Robin. Oh, no. The problem with options and why they're riskier than stocks is they have an end date where they expire. And if you don't exercise the option before the end date, they expire worthless. Whereas if you sell a stock or if you short sell a stock, it doesn't have an expiration date. If you buy a stock, it doesn't have an expiration date. Whereas calls and puts do. So they're riskier. Blockbuster stock up 700. No, it's not. Does Blockbuster even exist? I don't think Blockbuster exists. Futures can go negative. Theoretically, they can. Blockbuster still exists, man? No. No. A penny stock on the over-the-counter market. That was in 2017. Blockbuster liquidating, chat. What, to 5 cents? Could something like this actually keep GameStop alive for longer in the short term? So the answer to that is yes, if GameStop issues shares. That takes some time. They would have to issue shares, in other words, dilute the stock and sell it on the open market. That's actually the purpose of stocks, is to raise money for a company by selling shares of ownership in the company. So they could dilute the shares of ownership in the company now and go and grab a bunch of cash. So technically all this pumping is, this is not going to GameStop. When you buy a stock on the market, unless it's an IPO, that money is not going to the company. That's just a second, this is a secondary market of people who bought their shares from people who sold them in the IPO period, or people who got shares issued to them as owners in the original sense. There is no money going to GameStop from this. However, GameStop could get money if they issue more shares. 2008, new consoles released. 2013, new consoles released. 2019, new consoles released. All subsequent years, they did well. Again, this is not regarding Wall Street blades and fading. GME would have had likely gone up this year regardless, but maybe only a few dollars. True. True. But we're in full-on delusional mode. You know who else is in delusional mode? Fucking Tesla. Tesla's the same shit, folks. Tesla is the same delusional ass shit. Was it a company that had promise? Is the battery market something that's important for the future? Yes. Are electric cars important for the future? Yes. Are solar panels important for the future? Yes. Is it a $1 trillion company? No. We call these bubbles, folks. We call these bubbles. Now, Tesla has had more of a slope of just this kind of growth, but the price to earnings multiple is 1757. What's the price to old? Let's just look at GE. I'm just curious. PE of GE is 29.95. They had a $95.21 billion revenue in 2019 for GE. Let's look at GM. GM's is a 22 PE. So when you compare GE, which makes 20 million cars a year and trucks, to Tesla making 500,000 cars in a year, 1 million total, I think maybe an 1800 PE might be a little bit much. This video is a good explanation.
Hey, everybody. Okay. How's it going?
Okay, now. My explanation was better than Louis Rossman's explanation. I tripled my money over the weekend from GME. Did you sell? Have you sold yet? What was yesterday's trade action like? Just kind of a gentle rising action. So Monday had like a peak and a drop, and then it stayed flat. Look, listen. What I'm trying to say is, if you want to make these plays, understand what they are. You are doing speculative trades based upon the theory of the greater fool that you can spook Wall Street into covering their shorts and cause a short-term spike in the underlying security. You're not investing in GameStop. You're not investing in AMC. You're not investing in Bed Bath & Beyond. You think you can manipulate the price up in for the short term and make a quick buck. If that's your mentality and you're willing to burn that money, that's one thing. Don't come in here with, AMC is actually a really good investment with people coming back to the movie theaters and GameStop has a new CEO. Shut the fuck up. Get the hell out of here. I'm trying to save you. Because if you start believing your own bullshit, you might actually hold too long. Understand what this is. A day trade. A week trade. You're in, you're out. You're going to take profits off the table. You get in, you double your money, you take the money you invested out. You put it in there. You let the house money ride. You know? You don't sit there going, I'm going to hold. You put $10,000 in, you take $10,000 out. You start laddering out of this thing when it has a ridiculous, absurd spike that makes no sense, which is what this is. That's how you actually make money. These are just hypothetical trade ideas, not personal advice. CNBC's David Faber said he is hearing a number of hedge funds are in similar trouble than Melvin Capital saw in GameStop and may need to be bailed out. Over the past 25 years, IBM has bought back $165 billion of its stock. Its current market cap, $104 billion. If IBM had just kept those $165 billion worth of cash under the mattress, they would have made money compared to actually buying back their own stock. Ban, stock, open market, stock buybacks. Amazing. Amazing. They could have put $165 billion of investment into America. and manufacturing and R&D and marketing and product development and wage increases on literally anything or nothing, and their company would be worth more. Who made that legal? Ronald Reagan. One of the things about this is, you know who some of the most diabolical Marxists are? The people that are the most diabolical, who think that markets are the most irrational, that try to manipulate things? Hedge fund managers. Did you know that Kramer? Yeah, that Kramer. Used to be a Trotskyist. So he went from being a Trotskyist, this Kramer.
As goes bear, goes the Dow. Even though bear is not on the Dow.
Right.
Okay, that's sort of how it went. So, Jim, here's how we start out the day.
Okay.
Everything sort of starts out down a little bit, but nothing to worry about. Ah, boring summer fight. Almost, you know, a day we haven't had in a
long
time.
This is from the last crash. This is from the last crash.
Right. Just not exciting. Then all of a sudden, S&P says, ooh, we're worried about bear.
Right.
Bear goes down, market goes down. And then all of a sudden, things kind of calm down. Bear comes out and says, hey, we're okay, guys. We're okay. Everything's fine. Bear goes back up to neutral. Market's only down 20.
Right.
Then bear comes out and says, oh, worst bond market in 22 years.
Yeah.
And that's where we are right now. And the market's down 100 points.
Memo
How
to
do
bear
you trade
Stern,
this?
Memo to Bear Stearns. You got to adopt a Henry Ford attitude here, which is never explain, never complain. And they didn't do that. You keep your mouth shut during this period. You don't say a thing, because you're going to say something
but
that people don't like.
But then we complain, and we say, hey, come on, guys,
keep your mouth shut.
Come out here and talk about your exposure.
No, you speak softly, and you wait to that level where you think the shorts have overdone the stock, and then you do what Dick Fold did in 19.
Just so you have context, Bear Stearns was a New York-based global investment bank, securities trading, and brokerage firm that failed in 2008 as part of the global financial crisis and recession.
1998, you pick up the phone to guys like me and you say, 32 billion. That inspires more fear. I don't want to create fear. I like Bear Stearns very much, but I think that at this stage, this is not a good call. They shouldn't have done it. And they should have just said, you know what?
Mm-hmm.
We're doing well, and don't say another thing.
Dick Fold is a guy's name. It's an actual guy's name.
It does not inspire confidence to have 10 headlines coming over about what to do.
Hey, Chad, do you know what that stock went to? The one that they showed $110 there on that chart? Do you know what the price of a Bear Stearns stock is right now? Zero.
I don't like it.
All right, I hear you. Now, I still, though... You know, when we said,
and
hey,
look, the Dow can rally. We've seen the Dow rally.
No, I know. I'm not even, but I mean, it's just interesting, this bigger
issue
for companies.
This is about Bernanke. He has to be on that call. Forget the investors. The investors are going to do, if Bernanke
I'm
listens,
sure someone
Bernanke needs to open the discount window. That's how bad things are out there. Bernanke needs to focus on this. Alan Greenspan told everyone to take a teaser rate and then raise the rate 17 times. And Bernanke is being an academic. It is no time to be an academic. It is time to
actually,
get
we need
on
to
the
back up. Need to back
can rally. We've seen the Dow
rally.
No,
I'm not even, but I mean, it's just interesting, this bigger issue
This is
for
about
companies.
Bernanke. This is about Bernanke. He has to be on
DIY,
that call.
Thanks for the
Forget prime. The investors.
Conversion.
The investors are going to do, if Bernanke
I'm
listens,
sure someone
Bernanke
from
needs to open the discount window. That's how bad things are out there. Bernanke needs to focus on this. Alan Greenspan told everyone to
that
take
I
a
am,
teaser rate
you.
And then raise the rate 17 times. And Bernanke is being an academic. It is no time to be an academic. It is time to get on the Bear Stearns call. Listen, open the darn Fed window. He has no idea how bad it is out there. He has no idea. He has no idea.
Kramer.
I have talked to the heads of almost every single one of these firms in the last 72 hours, and he has no idea what it's like out there. None. And Bill Poole has no idea what it's like out there. My people have been in this game for 25 years, and they are losing their jobs, and these firms are going to go out of business, and he's nuts. They're nuts. They know nothing.
Kramer.
I have not seen it like this since I went 5-bid for a 500,000 shares of Citigroup and I got hit in 1990. This is a different kind of market, and the Fed is asleep.
Okay, but here's the
thing. Bill Poole is a shame. He's shameful.
Hold on. I know
he
you're
ought to go and read
this,
the accredited home document. At least I read the darn thing.
Hold on. I know you're passionate, and I hear you. But at the same time, a lot of people are saying this is yes. There's certain types of mortgages that aren't available. There are all sorts of issues. You can't get a darn loan if you're rich like me. But Kramer, if he did what you said, which seems to me from the way
you just explained yourself, cut the rate. Open the discount window.
Okay,
cut the rate. We'll leave the pressure.
Next week and cuts rates.
We'll leave the pressure.
You're gonna have. That's going to cause Armageddon.
No, we have Armageddon. I wouldn't try to cause it. We have Armageddon. In the fixed income markets, we have Armageddon.
No, but that's not what they say.
We have Armageddon.
They say, even when I've talked to a couple bank CEOs, they don't say it's Armageddon.
Well, they say
it's repricing. They're very firm about that.
Oh, great. Okay, well, let them be calm and then have them call me on the way home like they do every night and tell me, Kramer, what are you going to do about it? Are you going to help us? Are you going to help us? Are you going to stand on the sideline? Like
Radical Radishin, thank you for the 20.
Will somebody
Holy shit.
Come on TV and tell the truth about how bad it is.
But a lot of people say, these same people say, it's not Ben Bernanke and the rate that matters. The bond market
is completely separate from the rate. It's entirely the rate. Look, we'll spend billions in Iraq to build homes. We are going to have thousands of people. We have thousands of people losing their homes right now. 14 million people took a mortgage in the last 3 years. 7 million of them took teaser rates or took piggyback rates. Mm-hmm. They will lose their homes. This is crazy.
Yes.
I am sorry to be upset about it, but you have to understand what they're saying to me off the record before I come in here every night and every day. And what I hear from these blowhard managers who act like, call someone for heaven's sake. Go call someone. I worked at fixed income at Goldman Sachs. This is not the time to be complacent.
All right.
I mean, sometimes I wish I didn't know anybody so I could just sit here and say, you know what? Just go buy some Washington Mutual and take that yield. Unfortunately, I know too many people and I'm too darn old.
You are 62.
I've just been around for too long. I mean, look, I got to tell you, he has got to listen to, he's got to call somebody. Bernanke has to call someone.
So that was the last time we had a global recession. Did you see what happens? The last time we had a global recession. Now that we have coronavirus and the stock market's up, everyone's fine. All these millions of people losing their homes. Who gives a shit? And he was 100% right. And Bear Stearns went belly up. And then we had a global financial crisis. And what happened? Big Daddy government came and bailed all those motherfuckers out. So Kramer, he is a piece of shit. But he used to be a communist. And why was he making money on Goldman Sachs? Because did he think the markets were rational? Did he walk around going, efficient market hypothesis, every stock is perfectly priced. All information about the stocks is factored in with the price. You don't need to have any regulation. All the information is perfectly in there. No, he was like, fuck this. I can pump this shit. I can manipulate this shit. Also, where's all your perfect market people right now? Where's all your libertarians? Where's all your perfect market people? I thought stocks and markets had all the information, even hidden information. Did you know there are people arguing that we should get rid of insider trading laws? Because there's no such thing as insider trading. Did you know that? That's the position of much of the Republican Party. Where are you now, motherfucker? Oh, I know what you're gonna do. You're gonna run in and you're gonna try to gut the retail investors. That's what's actually gonna happen. So what's going on in GME right now? Okay, we're back down to 350.
Because Iceland didn't bail out their banks and instead prosecuted the bankers and turned much of the financial decision-making over to the women, their economy has completely recovered. In fact, it's doing better than ever.
And, you know, we looked at GM. How is AMC doing? Wow, AMC went up to 20, down to 11, and is back up to 15. Literally, when Robinhood came live again, AMC spiked. How's Bed & Bath & Beyond doing? Bed Bath & Beyond was $25 on the 21st, and is now at 50. And the biggest dumbass play is GameStop. We are literally experiencing this happening right now. GameStop's surge has made its three largest shareholders billions overnight. GameStop's parabolic stock surge over the past 2 weeks has created more than $2 billion of personal wealth for the company's three biggest individual shareholders. Ryan Cohen, co-founder of Chewy, who owns 13% stake. The other big GameStop winner is David Donald Foss, the 76-year-old founder and CEO of Credit Acceptance Corp., a subprime auto lender. And GameStop CEO George Sherman has seen his 3.4 stake in the company jump in value of about $350 million. Call them the Reddit rich. GameStop's parabolic stock surge of the past 2 weeks, driven partly by the Wall Street Bets crowd, has created more than $2 billion of personal wealth for the company's three biggest individual shareholders. While it may not last long, the massive shareholder gains accelerated in such a short time gave new meaning to the notion of instant wealth in the digital age. The chief beneficiary of GameStop's rise is Ryan Cohen, co-founder of Chewy, who made an investment in GameStop last year in an effort to help the company.
And earlier this hour, I reported that Melvin Capital now telling us that it has closed out its position. It is the latest chapter in what has been a wild ride for this stock.
They claim.
Frank joins us with another personality that's been involved in this. Investor Ryan Cohen buying shares of GameStop last August was a risky bet, but given the stock's meteoric rise, the bet paid off handsomely. Robert.
Good morning, Andrew. And again, great reporting by you this morning on GameStop. Now, we're just going to use the market close yesterday to measure all this because who knows where it's going to open today. But GameStop creating more than $2 billion in wealth for its biggest share.
Now, it's only $2 billion in wealth if they can scale out of this thing. CNBC lying to cover their assets. I mean, I think there is not strong evidence that they've actually sold out. They've just said that to CNBC. So I don't know if they've actually got exited their short position or not. We have no way of knowing. They're saying it to CNBC. Probably it's not true.
Shareholders just over the past couple of weeks, as you mentioned, the big winner here, Ryan Cohen, the co-founder of Chewy, bought around 10% of the company last August. He added more to that position last month, bringing his total stake to 13%. So his investment of $76 million now worth $1.3 billion. Now, he's also, if you just measure that by day, he's made more than $90 million a day or about $3 million an hour for the past 2 weeks. Now, his other stock investments also doing well. He plowed a lot of cash from selling Chewy into Apple stock. That has more than tripled. So he's added more than $1 billion just on the Apple bet. Now, the other big winner here, many people haven't seen this or read about it, is Donald Foss. Now, he is the 76-year-old founder and former CEO of Credit Acceptance Corp. They are the subprime auto lender. Foss bought around 5% of the company last February for around $12 million. That $12 million stake now worth about $500 million. And this is interesting. The hedge fund manager, Michael Burry, he's that contrarian investor made famous by The Big Short. Burry owns about, through his company, owns about $250 million in shares right now. He would have made even more, but Burry actually sold off about 38% of his stake last year. So I'm sure he's sorry he did that now. Now, GameStop CEO George Sherman, his stake is now worth about $350 million. Now, this is the big question, one that Becky and Joe were also mentioning earlier. So far, none of these guys have sold, or at least we haven't seen filings yet. But if you get any of these shareholders, whether it's Foss, Cohen, Sherman, any of these guys selling a lot of stock now while the retail investor will get hurt, that's going to cause a whole other debate, guys.
Robert, you think the company should try to raise some money right now? That's what I'd be doing.
That's the exact type of thing that I would be. This is an actual good question, chat. This was an actual good question. Should the company be trying to make money? Also, this stock, this is old. GME is back up, although it's starting to leg down a little bit. Bull trap is in. FaceTime wonder, line go up. Yeah, yeah. Only us wealthy people can talk about the market works until you become one. Shut up, commie. I know a lot about the markets. That's why I know their shit. I know a lot about the markets because I was in securities arbitration. And when I was in college, before I was a socialist, I knew about trading. So I know how garbage, bullshit, and just rigged the whole system is. And how what we've done under Trump's administration is pump endless money into Wall Street through the coronavirus stimulus, through Federal Reserve and monetary policy, through the low interest rates. Like, we have done nothing but print money and hand it to the rich. It's almost incomprehensible, excuse me, how much money has been created and just been given to them. And it is kind of funny, I got to admit, to see a pump and dump fair value XXX overvalued. bearish pattern detected. Fast stochastic. Oh, no. EPS is... oh, no. Negative $4.22 per share. So for every stock that's existing, they've lost about $4.22. It would be perfect if it was negative $4.20. Sad truth about GME and Congress. The speed at which Congress will probably pass legislation to prevent something like GameStop thing from happening again will show you the difference between immediate for Wall Street and immediate for people waiting on those $2,000 checks. Robinhood living up to the name, Omega Law. So can anyone tell me what happens to Robinhood? They send the motherfucking sheriff after him. But in the story, King Richard comes back. There ain't no King Richard to save Robinhood. Okay? It's nothing but King John's and the Sheriff of Nottingham's all the way fucking down. There is no king that's gonna waltz in coming back from the Crusades to save our ass, okay? That ain't happening. Have you watched the classic Jim Cramer clip in honor of Hedge Fund Day? We did. Yeah, we watched it. We literally just watched this. Oh, wait, what? What's this one?
It's the most objective industry in the world. If your numbers stink, you're out. If your numbers are good, you get more money. It's the most Darwinian. It's beautiful. It's brutal. It works. All right, guys, let's roll. Buy 5 HMTT at an 8. See what happens. It's against puts. We're fine. I want to see if you can even buy it. Colgate opens up an 8th. IBM August 95 calls. I want an offering on 1,000.
Back in the day, they didn't actually sell. They didn't sell stocks in decimals. They were actually in fractions. So you would say stuff like up an 1/8. Up a quarter. Like, they didn't actually say, like, up 2 cents. It was... I was alive when it was like that, chat. They didn't have decimalization in stocks. That was pretty funny. I was there when they did decimalization.
Yes! Double down. I want 1,000.
Pfizer, 17.25. It's X. We get the dividends.
Sold.
A new faith is sweeping the country, gathering strength by the day.
It's 25, okay? It's 25.
Over the years, as a financial reporter, I've watched money manager Jim Cramer turn into one of the market's most avid missionaries.
Colgate, get me. There are 1,000 stocks out there.
That's a Bloomberg terminal, chat.
That could make you rich, totally independent of what you do for a living. All right? Like, if you had bought Merck in the 1950s, just bought 10,000 shares of Merck, instead of buying U.S. savings bonds, you would not ever have to work again. 46.75 bid cascade. I believe that stocks like Bristol-Myers, had they existed 100 years ago, there would have been no Marx, there would have been no communism, because what's happened is these stocks have made many millions of people rich, and they're going to do it again. Sold!
And they'll sell.
500 to 95 is 500 of the pars. 595 is 500 of the pars. Buy me five, ain't it? I want to bring in these shorts. I want to bring in the gazooks, Outback. Okay, the impossible stuff to buy, and HMTT.
The real trap for any investor in a market that's been as volatile as this one, where rumors sweep through the internet, is believing that you can get in early. And you can get out early, and you can beat the consequences. And of course, if everyone believes that, it means no one gets out early.
I want another 10 Boeing.
Oh my God!
Absolutely right.
Guys, you can get in, and you can get out. A lot of people in those forums want to blow up hedge funds, then profit from their demise.
I've also spent some time looking at these Reddit forums, and it's clear that the GameStop crusade has two main priorities. Number one, profit, of course. But secondary to that is this idea that a lot of people on those forums really want to blow up hedge funds and then profit from their demise. Now, the controversy has quickly formed two camps. On one hand, you have those who are long and encouraging other investors to buy. This has been personified by retail investors, as you mentioned, populating these subreddit threads, urging their fellow day traders to join in. Billionaires such as Chamath Palihapitiya, the Winklevoss twins, Elon Musk, cheering them on. On the other side, certain hedge funds who actually get paid to have some short exposure, their research propelled bearishness toward names like GameStop, AMC, and their losses are stratospheric. Now, Melvin Capital is a near casualty here this week with prior puts in companies like GameStop, GSX, and Bed Bath & Beyond. They've...
Oh my God, they're bullying Melvin! They're finding every bet that Melvin ever made and just spiking it! They're just bullying Melvin! Melvin thought, I'm out of high school. No one can bully me again. And then here the bullies come and they find Melvin in his Wall Street fucking office somewhere and they dunk his head in the toilet one more time. Melvin's like, I'm out of school. Now the fact that I'm not the prom king doesn't matter anymore. Now it's all about math. Now it's all about math. I do the math better. I do the math. Well, Melvin, you just got bullied again. You just got bullied again, Melvin. You just got bullied again. And you know what? I'm okay with it.
Since repositioned their portfolio, closed bearish positioning in GameStop in particular, but not without some deep wounds. Andrew Left also said today that he covered most of his short in GameStop at a loss. In between, of course, are the quant funds, which are riding the momentum higher. Now, David, as you mentioned, Melvin is the first case, won't be the last case. I've heard the same thing. Midday yesterday, GameStop short sellers were down $5 billion in paper losses for the year, according to S3. That's more than GameStop's entire market cap earlier this week. And many retail traders found success in the squeeze. They've made multiples of their money in days in what to them seems almost like an arbitrage trade. So they'll quickly find others as well. AMC experiencing that same phenomenon now. The hashtag SaveAMC is trending on Twitter, and it's anyone's guess what the stock du jour will be tomorrow, guys.
Hashtag SaveAMC. Listen. Hypothetically, if I made these trades, you know, I would be like, you know, 500% is good for me. Your nerd glasses, Melvin, is now in CC face. Of course it is. I really hope this goes on for a couple of weeks. Chat, if you really enjoy the stream and you want somebody, if you want more leftists on this platform and other platforms, actually go into deep dives about issues like finance and electoral politics, you're never going to find a better stream than this one. Here's some things you can do. I'm posted YouTube content constantly. We had another Jimmy Dore video. We had a not safe for stream debate with conservatives where Vosh and I in denims debated with a bunch of conservatives about voter fraud. You have the dumbass takes of uniting with fascists. Get in there. Man, fuck AMC. They've ruined the movie going experience and consolidated the industry and crushed mom and pops. Yeah, fuck AMC. Hashtag stonks to the moon. Okay, in all seriousness, I've seen this game before. When they start saying about the democratization of stocks, that's when you know the bull market is running out. While the top 1% have always controlled 70-80% of the stock market value since record keeping began in 1989, this is the highest level of ownership ever, other than the fourth quarter of 2019 when it was 88.1%. Who owns stocks? Households by net worth. The majority of people don't own stocks and they don't care. The NASDAQ is up 30% this year. 20% of U.S. companies are zombie companies. They only survive because the Federal Reserve is propping them up. You have a safety net provided for stocks provided by the Fed, but only a limited version of that for people who really need help. So when these spikes happen, they're overwhelmingly helping the very wealthy and not helping people. And so when you hear this democratization bullshit, it's not true. The socializing function of finance capital facilitates enormously the task of overcoming capitalism. Once finance capital has brought the most important branches of production under its control, is enough for society through conscious executive organ, the state, conquered by the working class, to seize finance capital in order to gain immediate control of those branches of production. That's an interesting theory. Has it actually ever been accomplished? I don't know about that. Please leave the merit-based, incredibly fair, and rational system of capital known as Wall Street alone. This just isn't fair to what's being done to them. I know people think this is fun, but why do we have a stock market? So productive firms can raise capital to do useful things. Bullshit. Josh, come on. You're smarter than that. Josh, you're smarter than that. Come on, man. Come the fuck on, man. Detaching stock price from fundamental value, GameStop is now worth as almost as Best Buy, makes the market serve the real economy worse. The markets suck shit, Josh, and always have. Whatever case there was about GameStop's potential for online sales being underrated by the markets does not in any way imply the company could be worth $25 billion, but that's what the stock price says right now. It's unsustainable. People are going to lose their shirts. That's true. That's true. But the stock market providing money for companies isn't even true anymore. I mean, the IPO function, the capital raising function, is such a small percentage of trades, it's basically a footnote. The actual function is just a wealth growing for the wealthy. It's just a speculation machine for the wealthy. Get the fuck out of here, man. Stock market is now Gamba Casino. It always was. It was. SPACs are the new IPOs. Does stock money go to the companies at all? No. Stock price going up can help the company a couple ways. They can dilute shares or they can make bond issuance where their high stock price gives them the ability to negotiate more favorable terms for the bond. That's it. But actually, like, GameStop tripling in stock price does nothing for the actual company or the employees themselves unless they own the stock. Eventually, every public corporation becomes run by financial people rather than engineers or people who know day-to-day biz, and that's when they go full predatory. Actually, Dennis the Bloody Peasant, I just made a really good point. I want to talk to you about American CEO culture. Most CEOs are absolutely not. Most CEOs in our country are not actually executives. They are finance guys. But the CEO in your mind are always the exceptions and not the rules. For example, I'll give you when someone says, think of a CEO, who do you think of? You think of Steve Jobs. You think of Elon Musk. You think of, who else do we think of? Jeff Bezos, right? Those are not your standard capitalists. They're scumbag capitalists, but they're different. Steve Jobs was obsessed with product development. He wanted to make Apple products as high quality and as aesthetic as possible in his mind. Okay, I'm not saying they accomplished that. That was his organizing principle. Elon Musk has this kind of like science engineering nerd. I want to do things with engineering shit. And Jeff Bezos, who I don't like, and I don't like any of these people. I'm just mentioning that this is part of the propaganda of CEOs. He was, quote, customer obsessed. He said that for Amazon, he wanted to make it an obsession about the customer. You wanted to return something, you wanted to complain, they would give it to you. No ifs, ands, or buts. It would be a good customer experience. The rest of the CEOs are bean counters. They come into companies, they have an MBA, they pull up a big spreadsheet, and they look at a product and they go, you know, Coca-Cola, if you shaved the thickness of your aluminum cans by 5%, that would save us $5 million next year. If we could just find a way to shave the aluminum. And they go ahead, they do it, and then what happens? Your Coke cans start bursting all over the place. You try to transport a Coke can home, and it's exploding in your back seat, and the product sucks shit, and you're like, what the fuck? I never had problems with buying Coke cans before. They never just exploded all over all the time. But that's all they know how to do, is just tweak numbers in a spreadsheet, get a number out, and they don't care about the end product. Then they'll go and mortgage things. They'll go and borrow a bunch of money. They'll buy back the stock. They do financial trickery to make the stock price go up. They imperil the actual company itself. And then eventually, the company fails, and they parachute out with a golden parachute where they're given $50 million to leave their job. But the propaganda around CEOs is the idea of these, like, quirky, hardworking, obsessed engineer types. That's not true. That's not true. They do that. Almost every CEO in America is completely interchangeable with every other CEO. They have a certain skill set that is easy to teach. They make the same dumbass decisions, using the same metrics. And they just gain massive wealth from it. And they produce nothing, and they're actually completely replaceable and not at all unique. Snur, thank you for the tier one. My company got a new CEO this year, immediately issues $550 million in stock buybacks. What a weird... Wow, Jack, isn't that weird? I actually think I have a clip from Steve Jobs to talk about this. Steve Jobs on product guys versus marketing. Or something like that. Here you go. This is it. This is Steve Jobs talking about what I'm talking about.
Something else.
So they were very skillful.
Yeah. But they did show us.
Yeah.
So, and it's good that they showed us, because the technology crashed and burned at Xerox. And what? They used to call the... What's that?
No, I was just...
Why?
Yeah, why?
He's talking about how Apple stole the GUI interface from Xerox. Xerox is the company that actually came up with, like, the mouse and, like, clicking on folders and stuff. That wasn't Apple. Xerox came up with that. Apple went in a partnership and stole all their shit.
Oh, very... I actually thought a lot about that, and I learned more about that with John Sculley later on, and I think I understand it now pretty well. What happens is, like with John Sculley, John came from PepsiCo, and they at most would change their product, you know, once every 10 years. I mean, to them, a new product was like a new size bottle, right? So if you were a product person, you couldn't change the course of that company very much. So who influenced the success of PepsiCo? The sales and marketing people. Therefore, they were the ones that got promoted, and therefore, they were the ones that ran the company. Well, for PepsiCo, that might have been okay, but it turns out the same thing can happen in technology companies that get monopolies, like, oh, IBM and Xerox. If you were a product person at IBM or Xerox, so you make a better copy or a better computer. So what? When you have a monopoly market share, the company's not any more successful. So the people that can make the company more successful are sales and marketing people. And they end up running the companies. And the product people get driven out of the decision-making forums.
So when he says product people, what he's talking about are engineers, inventors, people who actually make shit, like invent things and come up with products and solutions to problems. Those are, quote, product people. Marketing and sales guys are the hucksters and jivers, the liars, the paid shills, the people that go around making promises. They don't have any fucking skills.
And the companies forget what it means to make great products. It sort of the product sensibility and the product genius that brought them to that monopolistic position gets rotted out by people running these companies who have no conception of a good product versus a bad product. They have no conception of the craftsmanship that's required to take a good idea and turn it into a good product. And they really have no feeling in their hearts, usually, about wanting to really help the customers. So that's what happened at Xerox. The people at Xerox Park used to call the people that ran Xerox toner heads. And these toner heads would come out to Xerox Park, and they just had no clue about what they were seeing.
And for our audience, toner is what?
Oh, toner is what you put into a copier.
So that's 99%, and you know, it's so funny. You want to hear contempt for CEOs, go talk to a CEO. You want to hear contempt for capitalists, go talk to a capitalist. You want to hear contempt for rational market theory, go talk to a hedge fund manager. They don't believe any of this shit that gets taught in economics classes and is repeated by the Republican Party. They don't believe any of that shit. They know it's all a scam. They know it's all a scam. All right, let's talk about... when I briefly worked in sales at Zillow, almost the entire sales floor was former current addicts. We sold advertising space on the website to real estate agents. Such a scummy business from top to bottom. All liars, man. Of course. Me and the boys on watch for roving hedge fund managers. Oh my god! This is flying too close to the sun, chat. This is flying too close to the sun. Funny, but also too close to the sun. You know, you're getting dangerous. GameStop, AMC, Bed Bath & Beyond. Alright, when you're in the bubble, it feels pretty good. When you're in the bubble... It feels pretty good. It's pretty funny. You do have a little bit. Okay, so GME is giving back some of those gains. They were up to 350, chat. 370, actually. So they're down to 300 from 370. Where do you think we are? Where do you think we are, chat? In the chart. Let me bring the chart. Where are we at here, do you think? Where are we at? Are we getting the fear? Are we at fear yet? Bull trap? Are we still growing, or have we hit the top? We just got the bear trap. What? No, we didn't. No, we fucking didn't. That was a couple days ago. The bear trap was a couple days ago, chat. Here, let me show you GME. My God. Let me show you a couple days ago. Here was the bear trap. The bears, it went up to 120, and the bears, aha, we got it down to 60. And then, whoops! So, bear trap already happened. We already had this. We're just past the bear trap rocket ship? Okay. They're going to have to cover those shorts on Friday. It says short percent afloat, 0%. Is this wrong? Whoa, my God! The short borrow fee rate is 40%? Okay, short borrow fee rates. Anyway, GameStop short borrow fee rates are shown in the following table. The table shows the interest rate that must be paid by a short seller to the lender of that security. This fee is shown as an annual percentage rate. Lenders are funds or individuals that own the security that indicated to the broker that they are willing to lend it out. Dividends paid to a shorter security go to the owner lender of the security, not to the borrower. So in other words, you have to pay a 40% fee. Let me see if I can find someone else. Let me just put, let me put GE in here. So you can see what a typical borrow rate. Short borrow rate for General Electric is 0.25%. That's a more standard fee. Let me zoom in. This is a more standard fee. GME Is that and it's changing like hourly. Oh no 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 no. Holy shit. This is incredible. That's why I was laughing. I'm sorry. That's why I was laughing. It's high because they think it's likely to go down. It's because the volatility of the underlying security is so high. That's why. Can we see what the earlier rates were if I had a subscription to Fintel? Then I could. Wow. The short volume is going down. No data available. Short interest is the total number of open short positions of a security. A short squeeze is when a company with a high degree of short interest increases in price, which forces short sellers to cover their short interest by purchasing actual shares, which in turn drives the price up even further. Oh, it's required. Man, these motherfuckers are trying to get us everybody to subscribe in order to get the GameStop intel. Let me see what Wall Street Bets is saying. Okay, this is just... Okay, it's a Wall Street Bets thing. It's out of date. This is 4 hours ago. Who fucking knows at this point what's right and what's wrong? High-speed day trades are loving this volatility. This volatility is insane. If you want more leftists on this platform and other platforms that actually go into deep dives about issues like finance and electoral politics, you're never going to find a better stream than this one. Here's some things you can do. I'm posted YouTube content constantly. We had another Jimmy Dore video. We had a not safe for stream debate with conservatives where Vosh and I and Denims debated with a bunch of conservatives about voter fraud. We have the dumbass takes of uniting with fascists. Get in there. Get in there.